talking about the feeling of love, because I believe the season that we're going in today is about love. Amen.
Amen.
If you think about Christ and the gift that Christ was, I'm trying to find my range here.
You can.
Hopscotch. But if you think about the gift of God, how he sent his son to us, it was a gift that none of us deserve.
Amen.
And if we think about it, the condition that the world was in, it's almost as if we were doing everything we weren't supposed to do, and God gave us the most expensive gift.
Amen.
Can you imagine having like horrible credit, known for quitting your job the second day, and going to apply for a house and they'd be like, you got it, paid in full. That's not even a tenth of how good the gift of Christ was to us on Christmas. And we're getting ready to head into that season, but I want to talk on love, because I believe a lot of us are operating in love, but the question is, what type of love are we operating in?
All right.
There's three types of love, and I know our Bible scholars will say, oh, I already know where he's going, but I hope I'm able to teach you something else this morning to make sure that in this season, we're operating in the right type of love. Amen?
Amen.
Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Lord, we thank you for today. Lord, we thank you for an opportunity to be able to share your word. Lord, I pray for your people, Lord, that you open their hearts and their minds, God, that they be receptive to your word, God, that they be able to apply it to their lives, Lord, and use it to be more productive Christians for you. Lord, I pray that you empty out all flesh right now, that you speak to me through your spirit, God, to be able to help encourage your people and strengthen your people, to build them up, to be more productive Christians to you, Lord, to bring people to your storehouse. Lord, help us to be able to show true love, Lord, when we go out to the highways and byways and wherever we go, Lord, to be able to show people how you loved us first, and we will give you the glory. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
I'll try not to be before you long, because I know we have communion to take, but I'm going to take my time. The scripture has been read, 1 Peter, the 4th chapter, we start verse number 8. I'm going to read verse number 8 for you, then I'm going to go ahead and get started. So, above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sin. I was at a funeral not too long ago with a friend of mine, and this friend was actually known in his latter years of being a Christian. And when he went to high school and all, he wasn't necessarily known for that, but he was a very popular guy. And he changed his life around. In his latter years, he didn't even know he was down, but he knew he was sick. He was known for somebody that was really big, really tall, really popular, but had love for everybody. And I looked at this as I went to the funeral, and I saw people that I went to high school with, and I saw people that I knew way back in high school, how the demeanor had changed because this guy had changed. He was a leader among people and didn't even realize it. And one of his friends stood up, one of his best friends, and he said, you know what? Out of everything I can remember about this guy is that he showed me true love. He never judged me. He never prejudged me what I was doing. No, he always showed me love. There's a quick story that I'm going to tell. There was a violinist, and he was in the subway, and he was playing the violin. Of course, you know how they have the buckets out, and all to be tipped, and all this. So after about an hour or so, he got $35 for playing his violin in the subway. Two nights before then, he had played that same violin worth over $1.3 million in a symphony where people paid $100 to see him play. It was a test done to see how the appearance of people would judge how much people would invest in. People looked at this guy in the subway and said, look at this violinist, look what he's doing.
See?
I'm going to tip him a little because he's all right to play. And this guy was a master musician, a millionaire already. But because they had seen his appearance, they weren't able to show him the love. They held back on it because of the way he looked. How many of us are guilty of not showing people our compassion, our love, our best because of somebody's appearance, somebody's background?
Wow.
And we're stuck with looking at an outward appearance and giving them what we think they deserve, instead of giving everybody what God has given us first. Amen?
Amen.
There are three types of love that I'm going to talk about today. There's the Eros love, there's the Philios love, and there's the Agape love. Of course, we know that Eros love is more of a physical attraction love, the Philios love is more of a give and take friendship type love, and Agape love is the unconditional love, God's love. Amen?
Amen.
I thought Miss Mary was getting ready to jump in. But I want to teach on these three things because I believe in the season that we have, love is the most important thing.
Amen.
And if we receive the gift like we receive from God, I know a lot of us, when we're looking at Christmas time, that very important person, we expect a very important gift, right?
Amen.
And if they don't give you a very important gift, some of us are in trouble. You get a fruitcake from your spouse, you might as well find another place to live, right? Now, the first love I want to talk about is the Philios love. And when I talk about the Eros love, because Eros love is basically a love that says, I look at somebody and I think they're very attractive and they can do a lot for me, I love that person. Eros love is also like the God of love at first sight. You ever see somebody and you're like, man, I love her. She got it going on. Because everything that you see about that person, the beauty on the outside, you automatically judge what's on the inside of that person. So you've already given that person a big atmosphere, and you've already given that person so much credit just on their appearance.
Mm-hmm.
You've told this person, man, she looks good, so she must smell good.
Mm-hmm.
He looks good, so he must have a good job. He looks this way, so I know he has a nice house. You've already built up this stuff because of the person's look on the outside, the Eros love. So when we talk about the Eros love, the failure with that love is that once you really get to know people on that set, you still have to get through some boundaries before you really like that person. A lot of people mess up with Eros love because with Eros love, people fall in love and they mess their whole life up. Because they married somebody because it was good looking, but it can't cook, can't clean, can't find himself. God, I guess that. But they were pretty. They were standing there and looked good. And the rest of their life, in shambles, because they married on Eros love. Eros love, and I thought about getting easy, I thought about it too late. But I'm going to show you something called the love account. And it's the main thing that I want us to get out of this morning because I believe the love account will help us not only with loving other people, mm-hmm. but it helps us loving our spouses, it helps our love as friendship, it helps our love even on the job. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
When I talk about this love account, I want you to think about this is a balancing beam, well, just like a level playing field. Everything above my arms is in a positive. Anything below my arm is in a negative. All right? So when we think about Eros love and I look at somebody, automatically I give them a whole lot of credit on top of my arm. They look good, they smell good, nice shape, all these things, dress nice, and also they automatically have all this credit. I don't know anything about them, so I automatically give them all of this on top. Now, when I get to know this person, automatically we realize that some of this credit that I've given this person is almost like a bubble. Because you can touch it, and it pops. And the credit ends up going down. She got bad breath. Ain't got no job. All this she married. All these things happen because you set up a person, they're almost like this right here, and then when you get to know that person, you ever see somebody from behind, and they're like, you just wasted all your time. You stopped doing everything. You was like, hey, who is that? But you built up all of that already just by seeing that you stopped what you were doing, run over your finger, messed up everything you were doing just because you saw somebody that looked, you thought had your attention. They got your attention, they turned around, and he was like, oh God. And let me catch you looking. Oh, you looking at me?
Be nice.
Y'all, I see something, Pat. Hey, how you doing? But the Eros love got you there. Because that love that we already have on the inside of us, that is basically lust that we see. We're like, boom, this is what it is. Boom, this is what I need. Boom, because that lust inside of us jumps up and gets us in a lot of trouble. A lot, amen?
Amen.
The next love I want to talk about is probably the love I'll spend the most time on, is the Philios love. Because the Philios love, I believe, is the type of love that most of us operate in the earthly realm. The reason why I say that is because the Philios love, I'm trying not to walk back and forth. The Philios love is basically the type of love that says, you know what, if you give me this, and I give you this, we're even. We're friends, we have a lot in common, so this thing is gonna work out. Philios love is pretty much give and take, like as long as you're doing for me and I'm doing for you, we will be okay. An example of Philios love is this. You get into a relationship with somebody and you're both on an even playing field. You say, baby, how you doing today? You look nice, you just added 2 points to your account. Now you're on a positive two, all right? This look nice. You say something nice today. You do this. You pay so-and-so. Oh, hey. Boom. You did this. You're adding to that account. All right? As you add to that account, you build up a credit with that person, which means you can actually mess up and make a mistake. But as long as it's not bigger than what you already deposited in that account, you're still okay.
Be all right.
Because you have given that person enough to say, hey, you know, I mess up from time to time. I'm sorry. Look at what I've already done. Are we still okay? Yes, we are. Because as much as you have given that person has given to you. So you almost have two, like, Christmas tree accounts sitting around each other because you say, hey, this person has given me this much, and I've given this person that much. Now, where Philios love messes up is this. You're giving this person, you build up this account, you slide the gifts up into the account, you have all these things you're giving this person, then you realize this person has given you this much. So now, after a while, you start feeling like something's wrong here. Because you're loving this person, you're appreciating this person, you're pouring into this person's life, you're giving this person what they need, and then when you need something, they give you this. And so you're like, what is going on? So things start to happen in your relationship. It's still a positive.
Still looks good, yeah.
Still looks good. Mm-hmm. 0.7, is that what it means? Okay. But it's nice. You're still in the positive. But you start saying, man, what's going on? I feel like I'm doing more in this relationship than this person is doing in our relationship together. Am I making sense here?
Yeah, yeah.
So when you do that in the relationship, this is when the relationship starts showing cracks. Because you feel like, man, I'm doing so much here, and this person isn't doing anything of not doing their part. Because your love is based on give and take. Now, what happens when you keep giving, you keep giving, you keep giving, and you don't even see this anymore? What happens when you keep giving love, you keep giving love, you keep showing love, keep showing your appreciation, keep doing your part, and then you look and you turn around, and you're getting nothing in return?
Teach, Pastor. Teach it.
After a while, that account that has, you can imagine this Christmas tree on my arm, then start turning it upside down on this arm. You go into a negative account. I believe some of us know what a negative on our account is. And if you try to draw off a negative account, you might get an overdraft. Yeah. Am I in the word?
That's another thing.
Now, the same thing with that type of account. All right, we talk about a bank account in the negative. Think about it in a Philios love type of way. All right, now you've pretty much exhausted yourself pouring into somebody. And once you pour it into this person, they're not giving anything back. Matter of fact, they're expecting more from you, but not pouring anything into you, and you get into that negative account. You begin to resent that person.
You see?
This is the point where friendships break up, marriages break up, things break up, because they say, man, I'm getting so much into this, but I'm not getting anything out.
You see?
Because the account has been one-sided, and you have went to the negative. Because your love was built on the type of love that, hey, as long as you loving me, I love you. But your marriage vow said unconditional.
See?
So what happens here is, when you're on this positive account and there's one person walking around and all they have all of this for you and all you love this person, but they're not showing you love, and you start wondering, what am I doing wrong? Because you see how much this person is doing for you, but then you look and say, man, I wonder if I'm doing this much for my friend. I have a friend of mine that has a shop, and all he fixes computers and all this, and every once in a while I go by and help him and all this stuff, talk to him or whatever like that. We became friends because he was friends with my brother. And a lot of y'all know my brother died a couple of years ago, and he was like one of my brother's best friends. So it was kind of like he became one of my extra brothers. Mm-hmm. All right? So we talking all, and I encourage him and all. And I brought him something. We had a computer in our storage unit that somebody gave to us that we didn't think was that good, because we don't really know. I don't really know that much about computers. So I was like, man, you can take this computer, it's taking up space in our storage or whatever, see what you can do with it. Mm-hmm. It was trash to us. Inside of that computer, it was something in it that he needed to help his business to get better, some kind of power unit or something, I'm not sure. He told me, he said, man, you blessed me so much, I'm gonna give you one of my office computers that has 7 times the memory that my computer done. I still have like a desktop. My wife said, when the last time you seen somebody sit at a computer desk and choose a computer? I said, today. But I still have one up, but he was gonna give me one, and like, he said, bro, I appreciate what you do for me, and I'm giving you this. And I sit there and think, I said, man, what have I done to deserve a gift like this? In a way, I kind of felt like indebted to him, because I'm like, man, I don't see how much I'm pouring into your life to be able to receive something like this. I was like, you know, I didn't think it was fair. He started telling me things I was doing. I was like, okay, thank you, because you never really realize how much you're blessing somebody.
Right.
Until they tell you. And man, we're just living that life in front. But he blessed me. Mm-hmm. And it was something he gave me that I was like, wow. And he told me, he said, you know, he said, this is the season of love and you got to show love. He said, this is the way I'm showing my love for you. I appreciate you. I was like, wow, appreciate that. Now I have a computer that when my wife walked by, she could say what she wanted to say, but it's faster than her laptop. No. But that was a form of filial love. Mm-hmm. All right? Now, if we take that and we look at the accounts and all, and we go back to Eros love, mm-hmm. I want to show you something. Eros love, say you meet somebody at work. All right? And at work, you're always gonna be on your representative. You know what that means? You're showing your representative side. Yeah. Everybody knows what their representative is. Uh-huh. Some of y'all are in representative mode right now. You show everybody your good side. They're not gonna see your negative side. When you see them, it's, hey, how you doing? How's everything going? Everything, oh, I'm blessed and highly favored, blah, blah, blah. This thing is your representative talking. You're always in honeymoon status, okay? Now, when you get to work and you see this person is really attractive and really nice looking and all this, and you see them in their honeymoon stage, in their representative stage, you automatically start adding stuff to their account that you've already built up a false representation of in Eros love. Am I making sense here?
Yeah, it is.
All right, now, so as you start building on this account and all this, this person can say something like, I really appreciate you. You did a really good job. Boom. Add more to that account. Mm-hmm. You look nice, man. Those are some nice shoes. Boom.
See.
You added more to that account. Mm-hmm. All right? Man, that's, your hair sure looks nice today. Boom. You add more to this person's account. Mm-hmm. This is dangerous. I tell you why. You build up a love account, which is pretty much a friendship account, turn it to a love account. But the reason why it turned into a love account is because you had put so much weight on it. It started overweighing things. What happens when you take this filial love or Eros and Eros love combined and do that, you start looking at your spouse different. Mm. Or your friend different. Because you're like, man, this person at work does A, B, C, and D and says E, F, G, and you ain't saying this. Mm. So what happens in some relationships mm-hmm. is they build a relationship with someone's representative at work. And then once that relationship is built up, it messes up your relationship at home.
You see?
You leave the person at home for the person at work, and then you start seeing the person at work's real side, the representatives, leave. So all these false representatives that you built up begin again. Popping. And they're in the same ship you was in when you started on your other. I hope I just blessed them.
Yeah, you did. Wow.
Amen.
People leave relationship after relationship, building on this account. It's called the 80-20 rule. All right? They see this person that has 20% of what they're missing, and they go to this person thinking it's 100%, but it's just a little bit that's missing out of their account. They turn their whole account over on the other side that had a positive account in there, mess their whole life, and get 20% of a false representation, because you don't know what kind of person this is, how they handle their bills, what they are at the house, how they handle their house, what their relatives are like, what kind of personality they have after work, what kind of things they're into, what kind of habits they have, what kind of addictions they have, and all this. But you turned your whole life over on a false representation.
Right.
Of love.
Well, teach that.
Eros love.
You see?
Mixed with filial love. And what happens there is you spend your life over and over and over again trying to build up an account on false representation. Dangerous thing, amen?
Wow.
Amen.
Very dangerous thing.
Yeah.
So when you do this type of thing and you see that person at work and all that, and you mix those two accounts up, you're like, how do I get back on the right track? Is it too late for me? Is it over now? What do I mess up? Well, what you need to do is change the type of love that we're using.
Well, see.
This is the season of giving, right? This is the season of love, right? We're supposed to keep Christ in Christmas, amen?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, I almost got mad at myself. I pulled some stuff out of storage and it said Xmas on it. And I said, well, I was saving time. But I want, and that's facetious, but I'm saying you want to keep Christmas in Christ, because the world today is just making Christmas a gift-giving thing when Christmas was about a Savior being given to us. A gift that was given us that we did not deserve and could not afford if we wanted to. And even when we try to do it right, we still mess it up, but the gift is still
Amen.
The next type of love I'm talking about is unconditional love. The agape love. That's the type of love that God has shown us. This is what Christmas season, we're getting ready to head into the Christmas season, is what it's all about. This is the type of love that it doesn't matter what the outside of a person looks like. Doesn't matter what their background is.
Yes.
You have enough love left inside of you to say, hey, I love you. Mm-hmm. No homo. it's a phrase. I think it's no homo or something like that. Whatever the brothers say, well, I love you, man, no homo. The beautiful brothers be able to say that. That girl, that's my girlfriend, I love her. Da-da-da-da. But when two guys say, no homo, man. Brother. We show that. Alright? Now, when we're able to show this unconditional love with one another, we step into a realm to where we say, you know what? This is my brother.
Uh-huh.
Think about the relationships we have with our brothers and sisters.
Yes.
A regular relationship. Mm-hmm. Alright? To where your brother can do you wrong over and over and over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. But push them to shove. That's still your brother.
All right.
See.
Your child can do you wrong over and over and over and over and over again. Push come to shove, that's still your child.
You see.
And there's a love that you're going to have for them, even though they're acting a fool, that you still, most of the time, it falls on the women, you know, because men, we kind of like, psh. And you can live out there in the road. I don't care.
You see.
Because we try to put up that facade over there, but most of the women be like, come on in, baby. Mm-hmm. I know you to come on in, come on in the house. Just because the mom is always the one that's gonna be able to nurture you and always show you that type of love. But even in that unconditional love, mm-hmm. imagine if we were able to show that love to everybody.
Wow.
Yeah. Now, I'm gonna give you a little trick. Because I ain't dead. Mm-hmm.
Pray for me.
Pray for me.
Yeah.
With the unction of the Holy Ghost.
Yes. No.
But I'm going to give you a little advice. With your love account that you have, all right? How many of you have like a phone that shows the battery meter in there? Mm-hmm. Phone with a battery meter. Mm-hmm. Everybody in here except for Pastor. He's,
I got a flip.
And Deacon Curry, he's also.
With flip.
But y'all have. We most of us have a phone with a battery meter on it. The more you use that phone, the battery shows you got 75% life left, 50% life left, 25% life left, and all that. What if I told you that you have a love account for just about everybody you meet? For everybody you meet. Because even for strangers, you have like a stranger love account. All right? This is what happens. Some people you don't get along with.
Well,
some Christians, you're not going to get along with.
See.
I try not to talk religion a lot at work. The reason why is because I will not show any non-believer the dissension between two believers. So if we're talking about Christ and all that, I'm going to agree with you. We can talk about it and all that. But as soon as you start talking about denomination, you start going to this church and this pastor, this and that. I can't deal with that.
Right. Won't do it.
Because I look at this. I look at it this way. If you're showing division in a house, why am I going to need shelter there?
Mm-hmm. See? You see?
Jesus.
If you're already showing me that I got to pick this house and the church that I've been going to for 12 years is not the right church because so-and-so did this, and this church is the better church, and this pastor on TV is not a real pastor because he teaches this and this, it's confusion.
Uh-huh.
So you would rather just leave it alone.
Leave it alone.
I think about the elections, and the elections really hit me personal this year. I'm not a political person, but I believe it really brought out like the real
Whoa.
In a lot of people.
Whoa. Whoa.
And I mean to the point to where I was like, wow, really?
See?
And what made it even bad for me is how Christians
mm-hmm.
were able to take their political favorite
mm-hmm.
and prove in the Bible
mm-hmm.
why this is the one that we're supposed to vote for. Barack Obama, Romney, in both sides. Mm-hmm. Not one, this is the one. I'm like, okay, God, now where are you in this?
Mm-hmm.
Both sides are showing this equally. Now, if I'm on the outside, I never voted before,
mm-hmm.
and I'm like, the first thing I'm gonna think of is all these politics are crooked.
All right, yeah. All right.
Because this one's saying this about him, this one's saying that about him, I don't know enough for myself, I might as well not even vote. Imagine that on the spiritual realm.
You see? You see.
This Christian is talking about this church.
Teach
this
it.
Church is
teach
talking
it.
About this
teach
church.
It. Teach it.
I'm not a part of a church, and I don't want to be because of all these Christians.
Teach it.
Because the love is not being shown.
Jesus.
So, in this battery meter, what I've learned to do is I know some of my meters are small for other people. Smaller than other people, than for others. Okay, so if I'm dealing with somebody that I know my meter runs down fast on, I notice, like, anybody have an iPhone here? Where's the iPhone Nation? iPhone Nation?
What's that?
Bless the name of iPhone.
Okay. What's that?
That's what's that. Or Android. All right, when your phone starts getting to like 20% and it's normally green, what color does it turn? Red. It's like warning, warning. Your battery is running low. Warning. All right. So the same thing happens with us when we're with people. All right. So if you're with somebody that you enjoy, you have a lot of common, you best go filios love and all that. You have a friendship, give and take, and all. Your account is pretty much building up, up and down, up and down, up and down. It's pretty much staying on the positive. When you're around somebody that you can't really deal with as much, that meter starts going down, and you get a warning. Me, my whole body just get hot.
Yeah.
My head, I start seeing stars. I'm like, I'm really trying to deal with this person, but I can't. So what I do, is I make a call to the vaccine.
Yeah. All right.
Because I'm a Christian. I want to leave on a positive note.
Amen.
They can't see me in the negative. I have a negative side, yeah, but they can't see my negative side. So as soon as I start getting those warnings, I'm like, man, look at this.
Yeah, it's time to roll.
See, man, yeah. I'm going to make a positive exit. Mm-hmm. Some of us, we got that pride inside of us. We're going to debate with people. We're going to that negative, and next thing you know, they done pulled out the worst in us because we're already opposite, or we're already working on a negative battle. So next thing we know, our batteries done ran out, and the real us just show up. And what I really want to say,
yeah,
is I don't like the way you say it.
Yeah.
Because your battery has already ran low with that person. What you should have did when that battery started running low, be like, yeah, you're right, man. Man, I didn't realize the time. Let me go ahead and get out of here. That way, the next time that person see you, they be like, oh, that's a pleasant person to be around. He's always in a good mood. He's always in the... I just know when to leave. That's some good advice. He's still working on me. That's some good advice. All right, now, with unconditional love, the love that God has shown us, simply put, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. What type of love did we do? What did we do to deserve this type of love?
See? Nothing.
Nothing. God saw a need in his people.
Yes.
Mm. And because of the need that he saw in his people, he gave his Son.
Mm-hmm.
How many of us are able to see needs in other people?
Thank you, Jesus.
Wouldn't it be nice if we was able to give love to somebody when we saw this need of love, instead of throwing stones at somebody that needed love in place? Wouldn't it be easier to be able to say, hey, you know what? This person's trying to make it. This person's trying to do so-and-so. I don't agree with everything, and all this, but I'm going to show this person respect. I'm going to show this person love. Because push come to shove, I might step in on Sunday morning after I done bust this person out, and they walk up in my church.
Oh, wow.
Now they can't even get through the message.
Can't.
Because they fixed on the argument that we had, or the last meeting that we had, and I can't get through to that person, or you can't get through to that person. Now they don't even like your whole church because you go there. How many times have you? How many times have you talked to somebody? I go to First Missionary Baptist Church. So, oh, is that church so and so go to? Yes. Yeah, that's the reason I don't even go
there. So and so said.
Right there.
Because you had a bad encounter, and the last encounter you had with that person was a negative encounter, and they put that whole taste on the whole church.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
See?
Amen.
Amen.
Because they're not showing love.
Mm-hmm.
Or they weren't shown love to start with.
Mm-hmm.
So, if we start changing the way we look at things, I have a story, and I'm almost finished.
All
right. We have to take communion. Mm-hmm. He's in the courtroom, and the judge was sitting on the panel, and all, and the prosecutor, well, the defendant was there, and he was, the lawyer went up and said, you know what, this guy, he did this, he's a liar, he's a stealer, he's a whoremonger, he cheats, he did this on this date, he did this on that date, he did everything, and here's a video showing everything that he did, proving that this is the guy that is worthy of being guilty of this crime. The judge looks at it and all, and he says, wow, you're right. I see all the evidence that's showing this person is guilty. The other guy's representative gets up. It's funny. He walks up to the judge, and the first thing he says is, hey, Dad, how you doing? He says, yes, you're right. My client has done everything that you said he's done. He did this, he was a liar, he was a thief, he was a whoremonger, he did this, and this. But on this day, he received me as his personal savior. And I wiped his slate clean. So the things that he did was in the past. And you forgave him for that, remember? Dad, church. They're working for you every day. They're not perfect, but their heart has already been paid for. Matter of fact, remember on this slide here, turn over the page on all the things that they've done. And Dad says, oh, that's right, son. It says paid in full.
Jesus.
God's love account. It's so powerful.
Yes.
That it doesn't matter what we've done.
No.
Yes.
No, it doesn't.
It doesn't matter where we've been.
All right.
The only thing that matters is now.
Yes.
Glory. The past is the past.
Thank you, Lord.
Let it go.
Let it go.
We're getting ready to go into a whole nother year. And the last thing we have to remember about this year is the gift that God has given us. What better way to end this year and start a new year than to accept the gift that is given to you freely?
Yes.
A gift that you don't deserve.
Don't deserve.
You have horrible credit.
Yes.
But you have somebody that is willing to give you a loan that has infinite.
Hallelujah.
You're not worthy of what you're getting ready to get, and you never will be.
Well, never will.
But there is somebody that's saying paid in full.
Jesus.
Over everything that you have.
Yeah. Amen.
Thank you. You know what God thinks about really means? You can't mess this up.
Love you,
Jesus.
That's true.
You can't mess this account up.
Mess it up.
I love you no matter what.
No matter.
Thank you, Lord.
What if we operate in this type of love?
All right.
What if we operated with this type of heart? To be able to show the same love that someone showed us to somebody else. You know what someone wants to do? Someone wants to have to make phone calls. Look, I'm sorry for what I did such and such and such time. I'm burying a hatchet. Some of us will just have to keep our mouth shut. And forgive and let go.
Yes, yes.
Some of us would just have to move on.
Yes.
And let go and let God have his way.
Amen.
And say, you know what I did in the past is the past, but this day forward, there's a love that I'm going to show.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
That's an unfair love. But it was unfair to me, and I'm going to show it to everybody else. I'm not working at Eros love anymore because beauty shall fade away.
Come on.
After a while, you're going to lose that attraction.
Yes.
After a while, that luster is going to lose its shine.
Yes.
After a while, that build is going to begin to shatter away.
Yeah.
But if you have a agape love, it doesn't matter what it looks like on the outside. Because it's not the appearance that matters.
Yes.
It's a decision that you've made in your heart to say, you know what? No matter what happens, I've given my life to somebody who died for me when I was worthless.
Yes.
Now for the rest of my life, I will try my best to live for this person because he thought I was worth it. And if I was worth it, you're worth it.
Amen.
If I was worth it, you're worth it. 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 I'm going to tell everybody.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Because it wasn't fair. So I'm going to pull you in while the getting is good.
You see?
And tell you that God is good.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
You all stand.
Hey.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Just won't do. I knew what was clear and true, and I can always find it in you, Jesus. The ordinary just won't do. I need a love that's clear and true, and I can always find it in you, Jesus. The ordinary just won't do. I need a love that's clear and true, and I can always find it in you, Jesus. The ordinary just won't do. I need a love that's pure and true, and I can always find it in you.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
not an ordinary love.
All right.
It's not an ordinary love.
No, it's not. No, it's not. No, it's not.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
It's not.
Thank you, Lord.
You can have all that other love.
Yeah, you can.
I don't need it. Love me on this day. Hate me on this day. Build me up on this day. Tear me down on the other day. Give me an unconditional
love.
Amen. Thank you.
That I can love my neighbor.
Yes.
Give me an unconditional love where I can love my spouse. Give me an unconditional love where I can love myself.
Jesus.
Jesus.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Praise God.
That's the love that you're looking for.
Thank you,
Lord.
Lord, we come to you today the humblest way that we know how.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you for the gift that you've given us.
Thank you, Lord.
Loving you for the love that you've shown us.
Yes, thank you, Father.
Lord, when we think about it, it's simple.
Yes.
But it's so one-sided.
Yes.
Because we've done so little for you.
Yes.
Yet you've done and you continue to do so much for us.
Yes.
This is not an ordinary love, God. But Lord, we try in our hearts today to show agape love wherever we go.
Thank you, Lord.
We're not perfect, God. But we want to be like the one that is. Help us and guide us.
Please, Lord.
Direct us in the right path.
Yes, Lord.
Build up our batteries that are weak for other people to give us more patience.
Yes.
To show more love before we make an exit out of the room.
Thank you.
And show us that you're building up these batteries of personal relationships. So we can give you the glory for this.
Yes.
Build up relationships in your church house, in the homes, on their jobs, in the church house, to where we're showing a pure love, the love that you've shown us. Lord, I pray not only for the relationship that we have with one another, but Lord, I pray if there's anybody in the sound of my voice that does not have a relationship with you, that you touch their hearts right now. That you prove to them that there is a love that can love them in spite of them. And you are that love. Show them, God, that you are the love that will never leave them nor forsake them. And that you'll always be there. Lord, we love you, we bless your name.
Yes.
We kiss your presence in the temple. Because you've been so good to us.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
So many things we take for granted, but you've been good to us. And for that, we say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Forever indebted to you.
Yes, Lord.
But you say paid in full.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
And we love you for that.
Thank you, Lord.
Is anybody in this time of us? When you say, Pastor Coleman, I want to experience that type of love. I want to ask Christ to come into my life. I want to be born again. So many people try to make salvation seem so hard. I just told you how simple it was. You're accepting a gift that you don't deserve. Don't have. All you have to do is believe and try with a made up mind that you're going to live your life for him and he'll take care of the rest. Amen?
Amen.
This is not an ordinary love.
Yes.
It's not an ordinary love.
Thank you, Jesus.
But it's for everybody. Amen?
Amen.
All heads are bowed and all eyes are closed. You're under the sound of my voice and you're saying, I want to do this over again. I want to accept Christ as my personal Savior. I'm not going to point you out, but I'm going to do this right here. We're going to say a prayer after we get ready to finish. And it's a sinner's prayer. If you believe this prayer in your heart, God will save you right where you are. You're You don't have to look for fireworks from heaven and all these things that happen. All you have to do is believe this within your heart.
Yeah.
And God will save you.
Yeah.
It's the belief in your heart that changes the soul. Amen.
Amen.
As we pray in unison, you pray this prayer in your heart. And if you mean it from your heart for the first time, the second time, the third time, if you mean it, God will save you right where you are. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Repeat after me, say, Dear God, I am a sinner. Please forgive me of all of my sins.
Please forgive me of all my sins.
I know Jesus died on the cross for me.
I know Jesus died on the cross for me.
I know that he was buried.
And
that he rose again. On the third day. Now will you please come live in my heart?
Please come live in my heart.
And save my soul.
Save my soul.
So I can live for you.
So I can live for you.
Help me to show an unconditional love.
Help me to show an unconditional love.
To the people that I know.
The people that I know.
And the people that I don't know.
The people that I don't know.
The very same love that you've shown me.
The very same love you've shown me.
I will try my best to show to others.
I will try my best to show.
Thank you for saving me.
Thank you for saving me.
In Jesus' name I pray.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Folks, we believe if you pray that prayer and you believe it from your heart, that God saved you right where you are. We say, well, what do I do now? You get into a Bible-believing church. You get a Bible you can read. Read it for understanding, not for living. Get around people that you know are building you up in a life relationship with God. And God will take care of the rest.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.